National Institute of Technology Surat, who will share his knowledge in the field of power converters. He is associate professor in the Department of Electrical Engineering with specialization in the field of AC and DC drives, advanced electric drives, active filters, high power factor converters, multi-level converters, DC to DC converters, and power converters for photovoltaic applications. He has published several research papers in reputed journals and supervising PhD and MTech students. In the growing demand of the power with depleting fossil fuel and environmental concerns, the focus on clean energy has gained momentum. Generating power through various renewable sources leads to the new challenges in integration of power to the shared grid. We are fortunate to have Dr. Maurya, who has extensive knowledge in the field. I would appreciate and thank Engineer Arvind Gupta to arrange this webinar, which will definitely help us to understand the challenges and solutions in the field of power integration. I request everyone to kindly keep their mic mute. We will have question and answer sessions at the end of the presentation, if time permits. You may also type your queries in the chat box. So may I now welcome Dr. Rakesh Maurya to please proceed with his presentation. Over to you, doctor. Thank you very
much. Thank you, sir. Thank you. How much time I have to present my talk?
Normally, we conduct for 1 hour. How much do you think that it will continue?
I think 1 hour is sufficient for me.
Okay.
Am then, I audible?
Oh, yes.
So 1 hour is sufficient for me. Okay,
yeah.
Sir. Okay. Is it visible, sir?
Yeah, can you make it full screen?
Yeah, it is already full screen.
Okay.
So, good afternoon, everybody. First of all, I thanks the Institution of Engineers, Bahrain chapters, authority of Institution of Engineers Bahrain chapter for inviting me for the guest lecture on the topic power converters for integration of in renewable sources to integrations. This is a brief introduction about the work which we have just now started since July 2014, and we are particularly working in the area of power control algorithm for custom power devices like DStatcom, TVR, and recently we are also working in the area of improved power converters for plug-in electric vehicle and electric vehicle charging, battery charging, and in last few years I was associated with the power converters for microgrid and nanogrid application. So with this small introduction, I'll be going to straightway outline of this our presentation. So today I'm going to talk about the power converter, which is the need of era. So I'll be going to talk about the introductions, in which I'll be going to cover the need of microgrid, need of nanogrid, and how it is to be integrated in the overall new structure of power system, renewable resources, renewable energy resources, and the DC microgrid particularly. I'll be going to focus on the DC based microgrid architecture, power converters for renewable integrations, and the few projects which we have carried out in our laboratory. One is the uninterrupted DC power supply for a small home, and second is improved power converters for plug-in electric vehicle charging, which is also act as a distributed generation system for some of the locality. And the lastly, conclusion. Now let us look at the smart grid vision for the country. The transform the Indian power sector into a secure, adaptive, sustainable and the digitally enabled ecosystem that provide reliable and quality energy for all with active participation of the stakeholders. Now if you look at the complete sentence, this is the demand of today's stakeholders. And if you compare these visions with our existing power systems, look at this power network. We have a power system in earlier days in which the power stations are located very far from our end users. And these power stations are generated huge amount of power. It is used to generate huge amount of power. And as the homes and the end users are located very far from the source, so they need to be transmitted over a long distance, and in between we have a network of substations and distribution transformers, and now it is feeding back to the end users. So here the participation is only in one way. I can say the end users are only to receive the energy, but they are not allowed to feed the energy in the power system in earlier days. So now we need to think how the scenario is going to change over a period of time. So if you look at the earlier days, the conventional power grid that connects home, business and other buildings to central power source, allowing us to use appliances, high voltage system, electronics, etc. And they have a typically a centralized generating system with the huge capacity. Now, if anywhere the fault occurs in the grid system, our end users are, everyone is get affected, those who are connected to that grid. So we need to look at whether this existing power system is in line with our mission that we need to think of. So how can we come back with the situation in which we need to have a more reliable energy to place it the matters. So now let us look at one more thought in which how many peoples are having access to electricity and how many peoples are still without electricity. As per the data says, worldwide, though it is growing from 2000 to 2019, the data says the number of people without access to electricity keeps on decreasing. And that is a effort of the every government to keep, to network the power system to the end user to the best possible way. Even our country, since July 2000, around 750 million people has gained access to the electricity in the country. So this is the situation worldwide also, but still there is need to, still World Bank data says 940 million people is still unelectrified. Let's look at this data in which the number of people with and without electricity is today. So still in 2000 till 2016, around 940 million of people, they are still unelectrified. So we need to look whether there is a challenges in existing network to go to that particular level, or we need to think for some alternate way of generating the electricity. So now in India, the growth of renewables are enormous. If you look at from 2013 till 2019, this is the data corresponding to renewable sources in which we have as far as the wind and solar is concerned, we have a rapid growth in their installation. Though the small hydro is also coming under the renewable energies, we are considering under the renewable sources. So though it is a consistent from 2013 till 2019, but as far as the solar and wind is concerned, it is gaining popularity over a period of time. This is the data from the Niti Aayog, in which our Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister, is the chairman. And this is the data. It says by 2020, we have to reach the target of 175 gigawatt of renewable resource productions. And in integration, we'll get 450 gigawatt is our priority. So we need to accelerate this uses more and more. Now, what is the concept behind this? If you look the renewable energy resources like wind, mini hydro, solar, some capacitor storage system, we have a good research in that area, capacitor storage, energy storage system. Nowadays, the hybrid car is getting popularity, and over a period, it is one of the distributed generation system where we can feed power to the local grid. Battery storage, the diesel, we normally discourage the diesel generators nowadays because of so many adverse effect of the environment. Biofuel, so these are the sources which are to be located at a different region, and we need to integrate them to make our own network. So this can be integrated in different form. It can be integrated either in AC network as we have existing system, or it is to be integrated in the DC form. And the later on, depending upon the distance, it is to be connected to the grid. So this is the overall concept of the system. The place, geographical locations where these energy resources are available, it is to be harnessed at that particular point, and it is to be integrated as and when required. As the need arises, it is to be integrated. And the best part of these resources are, they are the clean and environmental, it is pollution free energies. And one more thing which I would like to emphasize is, like the conventional generating station, these are located very near to the load center. For example, if we have a good sunshine, we have a good climate, we can connect the PV panel near to that locality and we can feed power to that part. So the best part, as far as the transmission is concerned, transmission network is concerned, that can be easily eliminated, that losses can be easily eliminated. So this is the overall idea behind this whole microgrid system. So wherever the renewable energy resources are available, that is to be harnessed, that is to be harnessed there only. And if it is access to that part, if it is access to that part, that can be fed to local grid. And if that local grid is further having access, then they can feed power to even AC grid through the central inverter or through the other inverter. Okay. Now, looking to the action taken by the government, though the government in present context, the government is taking so many initiatives to improve the energy efficiency by introducing new products, by introducing new policies to the government. Like under the National Energy Efficiency Mission, the government has just a minute. So now it is visible. Yeah. Okay, so as I said, the in order to improve the efficiency of the existing system, the government has taken so many. Yes, am I audible to all?
Yeah, you are audible. Dr. Rakesh, one thing. First of all, I don't think that we have introduced you to the audience.
Okay.
Okay, we'll do it later on. Okay, if I hope the recording is going on.
Mr. Arvind, I have already introduced speaker today in the initial.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Because there was a problem with my device, so I could not able to hear what was initially being done.
Okay, I think we can repeat that his introduction at the at the end again.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, please continue, doctor.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So as I said, the government of India has planned many initiatives for energy efficiency improvement, but it need to be accelerated more. It need to be educated society to do the to use that initiatives. For example, under the National Energy Efficiency Mission, the government has launched Ujjwala scheme for the citizen of our country, and they are forced and sometimes they are encouraged to use the LEDs in coming situations. Even the industry schemes are also being launched, and the result is also, if you see the recent energy efficiency program introduced since 2000, have allowed India to cut expected energy demand by 15%. So this is the initiative taken in 2000, and now the results is we have cut our peak demand, the energy demand, by 15%. We have also reduced the oil import by 8% and the gas import by 12%. Even the carbon dioxide emission is being dropped from the current situations. So we have taken initiative, and its effect is also being observed, but it need to be accelerated more. Now, as for in renewable and smart energy system, so in 2012, in context with the year International Year for Sustainable Energy for All, this is the Sea for All, the arena has launched a global energy roadmap for doubling the share of renewables. As we have seen, the renewable energy is gaining importance in last 10-15 years. Looking to that share and looking to the implementation of sustainable energy for the all, the arena has created a roadmap, and they have launched Mission 2030, and they have given its aspirational target under this roadmap, and they call it Remap 2030. Okay, and the chairman of this mission is the United Nations General Secretary and World Bank President. So in this, they have initiated, in order to achieve the Save for All under the roadmap 2030, they said that they concluded that the share of renewable energy in electricity sector will have to double from existing 20% to at least 40% to achieve that aspirational target. And the target is we have to share the double of renewable uses in 2030. So this is our target, and the government is working for that, and they have created different schemes, they have generated, they have a different plan for that implementation. So if you look at the initiative taken by the various country, renewable share of electricity generation has to increase substantially. For the developing country, the transforming the electric sector to absorb more renewable required upgradation and modernization of existing old system, and it will give opportunity to the new comers for the new and innovative solutions. So our existing system need to be upgraded. Along with that, some innovative idea to be enforced to use the existing system. Okay, so if you see the present system, we are somewhere we are somewhere here. Even in India, if you see, we are still using conventional energy sources, but the future is of renewable energy sources. Okay, just a minute. Few people wants to join. Just
we're not seeing the slides at the moment.
Just a minute. Now it's okay. Is it visible, sir?
No, not yet.
So let me stop sharing and share it again.
It's visible to us. Maybe it's an issue from your side.
You can see that?
Yeah, yes.
Because I was watching the slides, but suddenly it disappeared. Okay, now.
It may be the network problem.
Yeah, now it's okay. Yeah.
Now it's visible.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
So as I said, the renewable share of electricity generation has to be increased substantially. And for developing country, the transformation of electricity to absorb more renewable required upgradation of modern existing old system, modernize existence of old grid system. And that will open opportunity for introducing the new and innovative solution. Okay, so so there are many studies carried out in world community, and it has been observed that the transformation of electricity towards the renewable is already happening. But some of suggestions have also been given. Even the share of the electricity, renewable energy generations are to be increased much more. So there are international agencies, international energy agencies, in which they have predicted by 2050, the renewable sustainable future scenario shows renewable provide 57% of world electricity by 2020. So this is the projected data, but the idea is the era is of renewable energy resources. Now things, how to integrate it is a task of power electronics converters. So as far as the smart energy is concerned, now question comes, what is a smart grid? So the smart grid, the objective is to smart based and optimal utilization of all resources, energy resources. And to make this objective realistic, yeah, it is visible. Hello. So if you want to meet this objective, optimal utilization of all resources, you need to think of the generation, we need to think of transmission, we need to think of our existing distribution system. Even as our existing power network is not customer interactive, so the customer participation need to be encouraged in both the terms, not only the taking power from the grid, but they may be allowed to feed power to the grid. So we need to think in all the direction to make our power network more smarter. So as I said, the objective of a smart grid is to use all the resources optimally, And if you see the conventional way of power generators, power generating systems, in which the location is very far from the end user. But now there are technology, there are distributed generation, distributed resources, they are available near to the load center where the loads are available. So we need to think of the generation plant. We almost as far as the existing infrastructure of transmission, we need to, though it is existing and it is to be utilized, but we need to rethink how we can optimize it, their losses in terms of their power capability. The distribution system to be very, very challenging for looking to these smart grid issues. Customer participation is our prime requirement, because we need to make revolution in that area. Though we are in the existing system, we are taking power from the grid, but reverse is to be encouraged more, because nowadays in every sector the customer is our main customer satisfaction is our main motive. So we need to encourage this customer participations. Okay, as far as the operator is concerned, this would be IT enabled operator, a very good information network to be placed in the existing system to make it more smarter. The market as well as the service provider also to be changed. So as I said, this is the conventional grid versus smart grid slide, in which if you see the old system, we have a generating station feeding power to our utility, our stakeholders through this network. But in existing, looking to a smart grid situation, we need to exchange the power bidirectionally. So in order to do that, the two-way flow of power and the information in distribution system is required. So we need to improve our IT sector. We need to increase our automatic devices in power network for interconnection of the resources. And that will create, enable our active participations of our consumers, improve the reliability of the system, it will help to increase the penetration of our renewable energy resources. Okay, this is the definitions from some of the agency, what is a smart grid. So the one agency, National Institute of Standard and Technology, USA, they said a modernized grid that enables bidirectional flow of energy and the uses two-way communication and control capability that lead to an array of new functionality and its application. So this is a very challenging task, and it is to be implemented in the future to come. Similarly, IEEE has also given the definition for smart grid. A smart grid is a large system of systems where each functional domain consists of three layers. One is the power and energy level, and the second is the communication level. So they have given, and third is the IT and computer layer. These IT and computer layers are very, very important in present situation, because we need to satisfy the information, we need to satisfy our customer, particularly our consumers, and then the communication need to be established in both the way, as well as the data security is also an important aspect for that. So we need to look at how we can embed this information to our existing system, which is in present situation, which is lagging. So now let us come to the concept of nano grid, micro grid, and the power grid. I think everybody agree, they are familiar with the power grid, but the nano grid and micro grid may be the new for few people. So just to recap their refresh the idea, my concept of the nano grid is a very small unit of a whole network. Let us, you may call this is one house or one load may be considered as a nano grid. Similarly, the next neighbor to this one, each house may be considered as an independent nano grid. And the group of a house, when they are connecting together and they are communicating through the power as well as information, then we can call it a microgrid. And similarly, even in the offices, residential buildings, if the some of the groups are communicating, they are exchanging the power as well as information, then we can call it a microgrid. And sometimes when the power is accessed to them, they may be allowed to feed power to the grid. So that is called the power grid, complete power grid network. So even we have a small distributed generation system. Let's say the wind is one part. It is generating power, feeding power to locally. And if it is accessed, it can feed power to microgrid or it can feed directly power to grid. So that all concept can be built in to make the existing system slightly different than the existing system. Okay. No, so what is the concept of nano grid for me? The nano grid consists of a small DC network of low power, typically less than 1 kilowatt. Suppose if you have one house, maybe urban or it is remote area, their power consumption is even less than 1 kilowatt. I can consider this as a nano grid. A small network where all the appliances or most of the appliances are connected with the DC system. Okay. Now, as far as the voltage is concerned, there is no fixed guidelines till date whether it is to be 100 volt or it is to be 48 volt DC. So that need to be taken care or that need to be established based on the standards available for our globally available or globally accepted standards. Then we need to standardize this level of the voltage. So in one of the literature I found, if your power consumption is less than 1 kilowatt for a small house, that I can treat as a nano grid. The urban, maybe the requirement of 500 watt to 1 kilowatt, but even for a village rural area where the grid is not available, there you can even think of the power less than 1 kilowatt, 500 watt. One of the literature, it says the nano Navigant research has developed its own definition of nano grid, and they said the 100 kilowatt of for grid tied system and the 5 kilowatt for the remote system, they are considered as a nano grid. So even though there is no standard definition for this nano grid, but for me, I can say a one residential, one flat or one house or a one remotely located village home can be considered as a nano grid. Okay, so now if one nano grid is available, you may call it a PV, it is supported by the PV, and if the power is surplus to the next user, next to his home, that can be feed, it has also one more nano grid, and they can feed power to each other as and when requirement arises. And likewise, a network will be built. So a group of each houses is now going to be powered by the PV or some other sources. Or suppose if you talk about one is as a village, one village is considered as a one grid, one nano grid. Then the next village or next area, which is maybe having some different resources, they can communicate, and if the excess energy arises, that can be fed to either way. So this way the networking can be done. So this is the things which I wanted to tell now. So we have a nano grid. Each nano grid is communicating to each other, and a group of nano grid may be called. For example, in a village, if you have around 10 or 20 homes, they can be communicated to each other, and if the excess power is available, that can be fit to the microgrid. So suppose if you have, let's say, the 50 houses, and each house has a 1 kilowatt generation capacity, and if they are utilizing 50% of it, so the remaining power they can feed power to this DC grid. They can feed power to DC grid. Similarly, there is a second village which has a similar kind of situation, and they can communicate to each other. If their space means their location, their distance is not too far, they can communicate through the DC medium also. But if it is very far, then they can communicate through the AC lines also. So depending upon the distance between the two villages and even terrains also, they can communicate to each other. So each houses are acting as a nano grid, and a group of houses may be called as a microgrid, and two microgrid will connected to each other. Likewise, if you have around 5 to 10 kilometers of area in which 10-20 villages are there, they can be communicated to each other, and they can feed their requirement locally instead of taking power from the grid. So, and if the excess power suppose available in the radius of, let's say, the 10 kilometer, they can feed power to the grid. So this earlier the situation was the power system, power generating stations are located very far from the load center. But now we are thinking we have to make the each house independent, and they can generate resources, they can generate power locally, they use locally, and if the excess power is available, they can feed power to their neighbor, they can feed power to society, and if it is more than that, they can feed power to the grid. So this is the concept of grid integrations. And now when you are going to communicate one to others, means one nano grid to each nano grid, you have to communicate through this network. So the IT system is very important. So here, the same thing which I said.
Yeah. What could be the source for the generation of the nano grid?
Okay.
Because if you use the solar cells, then there will be power only during the day.
See, actual situation is, I'm just talking about the one entity of the nano grid. Okay. Suppose in one of the area, we have plenty of solar power. We can install solar in that area. Similarly, in the next area, though it will be the solar, likewise if the network will in the connect, I will come to that part, because different you can integrate. For example, we have an urban area where we need not to support by the AC. We can use the battery power to inject power to the grid. Means the battery resources can be fit to the grid, and that grid power will be fit to the neighbor. Similarly, in the remote area also, suppose we have a wind, so in some area the wind is available, in some area solar is available, in some area fuel cells are available. So they can feed power from the independent different sources. But in the, let's say in 5 kilometer area, we have to create a local grid in which it is supported by the PB. And apart from this, there may be the battery bank which can support it. Suppose you have excess power, you can feed power to the battery bank. Like in the distribution, suppose we have one substation in which the different sources are feeding, PV power is feeding, and it is available on the DC network, microgrid. On the same network, the battery bank is also being charged. And in case of unavailability of the solar, the battery will provide energy to that. Got it? So yes, the sir. One storage device must be connected in the network to charge during unavailability of the sources. So okay. This part we have already covered. So as I said, the beauty of this microgrid concept or today's concept is we should the generation is very close to the power users, and therefore it increases the efficiency and the transmission losses are neglected. So if you see the old concept in which the power was generated very far from the end user and the flow of power is from the generating station to the users, but now here we are feeding power, we are generating power locally, consuming power locally, and if excess power is available, it can feed power to the neighbor, then larger community, and if surplus power is available, then it can feed power to the grid. Okay. The type of microgrid, as I said, it will be of community grid. Suppose if there are places where the no power is available, the grid is not accessed to that area, we can call it as a remote grid. Suppose in the high terrain where the good winds are available, we can use windmills for that. If solars are available, we can use solar in that area, and that can feed power to locally with the some battery. Though the battery bank arrangement is not advisable because of their life, but that can be used if because the providing grid to that particular level is a very difficult task. Even the customer and campus microgrid, this is the place we are planning. Even in our campus, we have a prototype model in our laboratory in which we have connected so many small equipments, daily equipment in DC grid. So we can think, suppose if we have a SBNIT campus and we have a different buildings in it, around 3,000 people residing in campus, we can communicate through the DC grid. So the campus microgrid can be the one option. Even the nano grid, as I said, one small entity of a powerhouse means a home can be considered as a nano grid. So these are the different group of a microgrid.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah, Dr. Rakesh. Yeah, I think Mr. Srikant is requesting for join.
Just a minute, sir. So now it is visible. Yeah. Yes, it is visible, sir.
Yeah, it is visible.
Okay. So parallelly, I talk about the different benefits of microgrid. So we need to go for the distribution technology. A new distribution technology on the horizon, and the issue is we have to address the challenges of the aging of the present infrastructures, outdated and conventional design. So we need to looking to the distributed generation. We need to enhance the present system, and we have to look for some alternative, some advanced technology to do that task. That concept needs to be implemented through the advanced technology. Okay. So again, as far as the microgrid is concerned, there are two ways of connecting one place to other, one source to other. One is through the DC based system, and other is through the AC based system. I'm not going to touch the AC based system because of many reasons, because we are still adopting this AC based system. But let us look at the DC based microgrid system, which has several advantages. And the advantage is not only in terms of one aspect. If you look from the generation point of view, if you look from the consumer point of view, and then you look from the distance which you are connecting one microgrid to another. So that is in all aspect, the DC microgrid has several advantages. Like our most of the present loads, which inherently which we are using, let us look at the suppose the modern loads which we are having in our camp, in our home, either it is your, even it is your TV, your mobiles, your LEDs, your electric cars, every household appliances are inherently operated with the DC, because they are being connected through the adapter. And so as we have a present infrastructure AC, then the first it need to be converted into DC, and then the all peripherals are powered within a, suppose we have a electronic gadget, their powering is internal structure is powered through the DC supply. So at the front end you need to convert AC into DC. It means most of the modern loads are compatible with the DC supply. So if you look the present system, we have a power grid, and then we are feeding even if you see the some of the generating system, let's say if we have a distributed energy system, we have a, let's say, the car, then energy storage, then windmills, PVs, they are to be connected in AC mediums only. For example, we can connect, plug in this car to the through inverter, and then we have an inverter, and then it will convert into AC, and it will feed power to that part. Similarly, the storage is now DC inverter, it is being converted into AC and it is connected. So the, here the inter-integration of the sources are through the AC medium. Similarly, if you look at the modern loads, in which at the front end we have a diode rectifier, and then DC to DC converter, and then it is inverter. So we are converting and inverting. So all the CFL lights, they have their drivers, they convert AC into DC. Similarly, if you use, let's say use a drive system. So in the drive system, we have a fixed, we have a AC as an input, and we are converting them into DC. And then they are further, they are converting this DC, intermediate DC into AC. Means inherently in between, we are converting them into DC. So there is need to think why we converting AC into DC, because we have a present infrastructure in AC form. So we and the conversion of AC to DC through the power electronic devices, so they are much more, they are not that much efficient as compared to DC to DC conversion. So as I said, the DC based generating system, so the most of our generating sources, distributed generation sources nowadays, which is a renewable, they are a DC based system, and they can be they are generating power in terms of DC, and they can connect directly to DC through the microgrid through some converters. Suppose we have a AC system, we can convert through into the DC grid through AC-DC converter without considering their phase sequence, frequency, etc. Only we need to think the level of voltage, output level of voltage. So DC microgrid has a feature of reducing the losses, because there will be very few problem of reactive power compensation. And so we need to eliminate the reactive power requirement. Similar, so the grid can supply power to power supply to power electronics equipment directly, and we can eliminate the use of AC-DC converter as we are using frequently in present system. Okay, so as I said, why the DC network? Because the our most of the generations are in the form of DC. For example, if you have a wind turbines, windmills, you can convert AC into DC, and that DC can be regulated and it can be connected directly. We have a fuel cell, we have a storage, we have a PV cell. They are generating power in terms of DC that can be connected to the DC microgrid. And as I said, our present loads are DC compatible, so we need not to use adapter, we need not to use, even if for your laptop you use adapter, mobile charging you need charger, only a small data cable is sufficient to charge if you are dealing with the DC. So this way, as I said, this is the present situation. But now let us look at the we have a laptop, we have a charger, so why to use this adapter for that? If it is a DC supply, you can simply plug in and you can get it at a required, and even the size and efficiency of DC to DC converters are more than is very very less as compared to this AC DC adapter. Similarly here, if you look at the your notebook PC power management system, in the peripherals of the power management system, we have a different level of voltage. For example, 12 volt, 0.7 to 1.7 volt. Memory is required 1.5 volt to be powered through the VR. Then there is so many things. Even the ALUs, they can require 3.3 volt. So different voltage DC, inherently you require DC supply in the power in your laptop. But here you as you are having AC supply, so we need to convert first AC into DC, so we need adapter. And this will is the most in power electronic community, this AC to DC conversion is the main culprit of creating problem of power quality at the supply side. And they have so many reactive power harmonic problem because of this conversion. If you are able to eliminate this part, and let if you have a DC network within a home, only the small data cable is sufficient to charge your supply. Similarly, they can be used for your electronic TV also. So, and what are those converter, AC to DC converter? I'm just giving the small circuit for that. So in DC to DC converter, AC to DC converter, we have a AC supply and we are converting into DC. Here we are getting DC supply, and in between we require we have a diode rectifier followed by the boost converter. So this is the active arrangement by which we can convert any supply to DC supply, keeping this output voltage DC is ripple free. And the input current and input voltage are in phase, so as to create the unity power factor conversion. So these converters are very popular. There are variety of converters available, like in a direct non-isolated mode. This is an example of isolation because it is isolated through this flyback converter. Similarly, if you want power feedback to the source, for example, you have a windmill and you want to integrate to the DC microgrid, the single for single phase, this is the topology available, which is very popular. We can feed power both the side with the same conversion. So this is the way the power is being from the source side, the power will look like. So you have to control, you have to operate your converter such that the voltage and current both are in same phase when they are drawing power from supply to the load. And at the same time, if you are feeding power to the grid, in that situation, if only the suppose if this is the voltage, the current will be only reverse. So till this point, the supply, this is so the power taking from the supply system, and here the load is feeding power to back to the supply system. So only the current is out of phase with the voltage, and here current is in phase with the voltage. So these are the some waveforms associated with AC-DC converter. So these are the, even this is a three-phase version of that. For example, if you have a windmill, here you are generating power, three-phase power, you can connect to this inverter, three-leg VSC inverter, and then you can generate a voltage, and that can be regulated in a very small way. It is a very popular circuit, and it can feed power from windmill to this grid. This is the same thing with their control is a little bit enhanced, and we can generate three phase power from the grid, from the windmill, and it can feed power to this DC grid. So this way it can be power can fit to this grid. So as I said, there are various sources like fuel cell, solar, wind, hydro storage. Their output is of DC, and or even in the windmill case, if it is AC, they can be converted into DC using the above converters, and they can be here a small DC microgrid is available, or here the DC grid is available. As per the today's scenario, there is no common consensus about what should be the voltage level of this DC grid. So this DC grid voltage level is still on the standardization is not taking place. What should be the voltage? It is 48 volt or 110 volt or 230 volt or 380 volt. There is still questions because of a lack of standards available for this implementation. And as I said, our loads are mostly DC operated, so we can remove the usage of adapter in each appliances. Like this, we have a solar panel, we have a battery storage, and here we have a DC bus. We can feed power to CFL, LED, air conditioners, dryer, and if the excess power is available, that can be fed through this inverter to this small microgrid. So this is the concept which is to be built for the future network. Similarly, this is one of the literatures which we got. It's a 600 volt DC bus is created, and we have a utility here. From utility, we have a AC-DC PFC converter which converts into DC. You can use PWM rectifier for that. And here we have a windmill. Again, it can be converted through the same converter which we have just now discussed. This is the converter you can implement for that to integrate utility to the DC grid, even the wind energy to the DC grid. And so this way this utility and the windmills can be integrated to this DC. And we have a solar PV generation. As the generation is in the form of DC, we can use MPPT converters for that, and then later on it can be increased to 600 volt to integrate with the 600 volt. And as we have a storage, we can store power here, or if it is not required, you can feed power directly to grid if the excess power is available other than the load. If you have an AC load, for example, you are driving induction motor, with the 600 volt DC link, you need not to use AC-DC converter as you are using an existing system. So you need to use DC-AC converter to convert them into. Similarly, the DC load can be directly fed through a DC to DC converter. Why I'm emphasizing on DC to DC converter? Because as per the research said, the efficiency losses in power converters, DC to DC converters are very high. Efficiencies are very high. It is as close to 90%, 97%. Whereas DC to DC, AC to DC conversions, these converters are not that much efficient. And additionally, they create a problem of harmonics and reactive power compensation. So these are the issues associated with the existing. So we need to go for the DC. Similarly, we have a different energy resources where the power is generated in form of DC, like plug-in electric vehicle. You can use the inverter of your car, not inverter, you can use battery of the car, and it is stationary. You can feed power to grid, and if the need arises, even you can feed power to charge your car. So here we required bi-directional DC to DC converter to charge them. Similarly, in the storage, whenever the power required, you can feed power to grid, this microgrid, through this storage. And if the storage required charging, then it can feed power back to the grid. So DC to DC converter is sufficient for that. And the beauty of all these resources are that they are clean and they are very near to load. So the transmission losses are almost negligible. And as far as our modern loads are concerned, as they are operated with the DC bus, so we need not to use any adapter for that. And the DC to DC converters are much, much efficient than the AC-DC converter. For example, most of the electronic internal operation of electronic equipment require 48 volt supply. So that can be converted through a small group of DC to DC converter. Even the DC-DC converter, it is available in form of chip. So you need not to think even bigger size as you have a laptop charger. So that's are very efficient for that. So similarly, this is a DC network which is around your community, and you can through the DC to DC converter, you can communicate through the generation part. And if you have a high load, like which can operate with the AC, for that you can use DC to AC converter, which is a helpful. Normally we have inverter in our home, so that can be used here. So this is the this is the present things where the sources are, let us say, of the DC nature. They are integrating in terms of AC and connecting to the grid. But the new things is now the generation is in the form of DC, it is to be integrated in terms of the DC. And if the excess power is available, that can be fed to the AC grid through the inverter. So and similarly vice and versa also. If you want to charge vehicle, you want to charge battery bank, and then you can feed power to grid. So this role of these converters are of bidirectional in nature. So the renewable resources, mostly of the DC nature, it can be integrated through the DC to DC converters, and it can feed power in terms of the DC. And if the excess power is available through the inverter, it can feed power to grid and even for the AC load also. So this is the 300 to 380 volt DC bus in which the R generations are connected in, local generations are connected in terms of the DC medium. And they are to be communicated anywhere. Storage is in the form of the DC. And as and when it is to be integrated to grid, then it is to be integrated through the inverters. So these are the few peaks which we have taken for this. Even the multiple sources can be connected, because as per the literature says, the DC to DC converters are much, much ahead than the AC to DC converter. So we should utilize, and even because of the advancement in the DC to DC converters, we have a switched mode power supply, SMPS. And today we are moving in the fifth generation of research in the DC to DC converter. We are almost, it is close to 100%. And you can look at the left iPad charger. It is so small, and the switching takes place with the 1 megahertz switching frequency. So the size of these chargers are very, very less, very, very small, and it can be even integrated in your wire also. So you, from externally, you cannot see whether it is a DC to DC converter or it is just a cable. So this is one more picks of integrations. This is a small, these are the very primitive converters which converts AC into DC, and these two can be integrated in this form. And as S1, S2, S3, S4, these are the one bridge form. So this is the standard module available in as a product. You can connect and you can realize both the circuit through this converter. The same converter, it can be operate either power flow from A to B or from B to A, depending upon the switching patterns of these all four switches. So that can be possible. And why this is required? Because it is a standard circuit available in the form of chips. So even suppose in previous case, I said there is a diode. You know, diode, when it is on, it has a 0.7 drop. And if it carry currents, then there will be losses in it. So they have replaced this diode by a MOSFET devices. These are the MOSFET which is replaced by their diodes, because the on-state drop of the MOSFET is very, very less. So even the losses, switching losses within the device is reduced, and that will improve the DC to DC converters. So there are further advancement in it. Some more switching soft switch converters are also being implemented in the same converter. It is a conversion from DC to DC. Suppose you want to apply for charging the battery. So we can convert power from DC to this, charge the battery. And if you want to feed power back to this source, then you can use different pattern of switching. And the switching loss is almost zero, so that can be utilized. So almost all the primitive converters, DC to DC converters, are now increased, and they can be they are already reached to the maturity level of their efficiency, almost close to efficiency. So as far as my research, this is the I have grouped the appliances of AC to DC converter through adapter and some different, I have classified in different groups, 1, 2, and 3.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello, Rakesh.
Yes.
I think, can you check, there are few people are requesting for joining for a long period. I don't know, but they are telling.
No, but right now, it is not. Still
no one is there.
No one is in room.
Okay. Can you hand over a control to someone else?
Is it possible to do this control? Because I haven't done this. Is it possible to give control to others? It is because I have initiated the talk, so probably organizer will be mine.
Okay. I think we are on the almost in our ending stage.
Right.
Let us continue with our presentation.
Okay, sir. Okay, no problem.
Okay.
So as I said, I have a group of devices which I have. They are operated with AT-DC converter like adapter, and they don't use battery. Suppose there are the situation. Similarly, some of the adapter which are used to charge the battery of the appliances, and later on it is not required. And so the idea of conducting this grouping is, I have tried to formulate what could be the our DC grid. So most of the DC appliances, I have conducted many survey for that. For example, for a domestic home, we have connected the fan, tube lights, etc., DC equipment as well as AC equipment. And later on, I have grouped, I'll tell the grouping of the devices. I think it is not available with me. But so what I want to say, so by grouping, I have made the extensive survey of the equipment and how they are operated, at what level of DC they are operating. So that voltage, I have tried to figure out what should be our voltage. So in our lab, I have made 48 volt DC network, and I have tried to connect the three different sources for this DC network, and I have connected certain load to that. Even I have if a DC fan is operating and if BLDC AC fan is operating at different speed, so you can think the power level requirement. For example, a CFL, which is 36 watt, and LED is a 15 watt. You can make the intensity low, which is not, provision is not available in CFL tube, but in LED you can make the intensity low. Similarly, in the AC fan, if you reduce the speed, its power consumption, let's say the 60 watt. In BLDC fan, even it can be, for the same speed, it can be of 9 watt. So the consumption is very, very less in the DC fans. And it has been worked out, if you reduce, if you cut the power 10%, I said that 100 watt DC is sufficient to give power to our rural home. Because the requirement of a rural home is, nano grid rural home is a very, very less. Hardly they required three lights, two fan, one mobile charging, or you can use one TV, then three light, one fan, one TV is sufficient for their home. So if you talk about that, there are many rural house, 100 watt power is sufficient for that. And 100 watt power can be generated through different sources available near to their home. So similarly, if you want to increase the power, you can add more PV to get even 500 watt. So as I said, the nano grid may be less than 1 kilowatt. For rural, 100 watt is sufficient, and for rural with enriched appliances, they may add solar and they can get up to 500 watt. So this way the comparison work out. So the requirement is very, very less. And what we can do in the existing system, as I said, the existing system is not to be totally obsolete. It is to be functional, properly functional. For example, if we have a 330 kV substation, 33 kV to 11 kV transformer, under normal situation, in distribution transformer, it is 230 volt and it will power the existing home. Is it okay? Now, what I did, in present situation, either the power during the power cut, either the power is available with the 230 volt with the plus minus 10% variation, or it will be no power available. So if you try to just make an arrangement, you use load scheduling, you can do 90% power cut. Means instead of no power, if you give only the 10% of power for the rest of that period where you want load shedding. So if you make only the 10% of power through the step changer, you can make, instead of 11 kV, you can make 4.4 kV. And through the distribution transformer, you can give power to 90 volt DC. Is it okay? Understanding is clear? In the normal situation, 11 kV is now stepped down to 33 kV is stepped down to 11 kV, and through the normal situation, the distribution transformer will give 230 and it will power to the existing home. For example, during the load shedding, if I 90% power, if I blown power cut, only the 10% power I am feeding, so I have to reduce the voltage to, let's say, the 0.4 tapping, so it will be 4.4 kV volt. Instead of 11 kV, if in substation, tap changer will do the job and it will provide 4.4 kV. So through distribution transformer, you will get only 90 volt AC. Now we need to use, let's say, for you have a load setting for 4 hours. So for the 4 hours, you have to install just near to your meter, or you have to install one component, one device, which can convert this 90 volt AC to 48 volt DC. So you need to convert only AC to DC conversion. And during this period within the house, all the appliances which is compatible with the DC 48 volt, the wiring where the 48 volt lights are, DC loads are there, that can be operated. So as in an existing system, either we are having power or we are having no power. But in this case, just at substation, you can make the change, and in the customer side, we can use only this device. We normally call it uninterrupted power. This can be installed, and within the house, 48 volt DC supply, which can power less than 100 watt, or even 200 watt power equipments. So this arrangement required nothing additional cost in the power system network. Only the tap changing is required, whereas at the customer side, a small equipment is required, maybe costing of 5,000 to 10,000. Okay. So like we have a transformer, existing transformers in which the tap changers are there, and we can step down to the 10% during the load shedding period. This is the equipment which I am just now talking about. So with these three converters, I have tried to integrate the system So we have this very popular inverter. We call it a voltage source inverter. And we are integrating, in one leg we are integrating PV, in other leg we have a storage, and here we are integrating DC AC supply. And here we are making the DC network of 48 volt. So these three are operated in different way. And even the power management is done in such a way, in most of the time when the PV is available, it can be used. Then during this, the load is being fed by the PV source, and simultaneously it will charge the battery. And when the PV is not available, this battery is going to charge, going to feed power to this local load. And if even this two is not available, the last priority is our grid. So we can use this power through the grid. For example, sun is not available, PV is not available, and battery is discharged. Under that situation, you can feed power to the local load. And if required, you can feed power to charge the battery. So all the coordinated control of this inverter is being done in the prototype model in our laboratory. And it was successfully tested and it is working. So this energy management system, as I said, the priority is defined with the PV, then battery, and then the grid. So these all are operated in a good fashion. This is the different mode which I have just now said, it can be operated. Similarly, when you are harnessing power from the PV, we have to look up that the power should be at always maximum power point, because sometimes with the weather change, the power will not be optimal. So we need to control the PV just by controlling the one leg efficiently. So that is the part of control. I am not going much detailed because of lack of time. So that can be, even the charging pattern of the battery is also being done. So due to lack of time, I'm just skipping this technicality part of it. And I said this whole part is analyzed, tested 2-3 years before in our laboratory. This is the one setup which we have created in our lab, in which we have these inductors, which are interface inductor. Here we have a modular. We have a controller in which all the control is being implemented through the D space 1104, and it is being used to charge the battery. Some of the technical data sheets which we have here. So these all are the, as I said, during taking power from the grid, the power factor is always unity. Here voltage, current, both are in the same phase. Here the same voltage phase are there. This is the way the power is being fed. And a last thing I also said, there is a topology where the grid, suppose we have a car and we want feed power, or we want to take power from the grid. Again, the same inverter configuration can do the job for the single phase. So you have a independent home and you have a car, you can charge the vehicle with the utility when it is required. So you can integrate your wheel grid as well as your PV. So if you want to this PV power to be fed to the local supply, then it will feed power through this. And that is, in that case, the grid power is not required. Suppose your load is less, you can feed power to grid and you can feed power from this battery to local grid also. So that all provision is made in this converter. And this can be done. So we control up again, this three leg VSC is such that it will feed power from battery to local load as well as feed power to the grid. And in case if the battery of the car battery is drained, you can feed power to from the utility to the load as well as it will charge the vehicle. So this is feature. Similarly, I have tried to optimize this voltage source converter, and then I have taken only the two leg with the same configuration, and that has been so. The same thing, if the AC power is feeding to the residential load and at the same time you want to integrate this distributed generation of the car, you can feed power to local load as and when required. So this two work has been done by my research scholar, PhD research scholar, and now he is being awarded. So this is the control which is being implemented in the D space. With the idea to charge the vehicle and to feed power to the grid. And again, I have tried to calculate the what is the, see the voltage and current profile. Similarly, the voltage and current profile while charging mode. I'll tell the, this is the case where the power is feeding back to grid, back to the grid. So from even in the battery side, you can see here the battery power is current is negative and voltage is positive. It means power is going from battery to grid. In previous here, you can see here the battery voltage is positive and current is also positive. So the power is negative. So that way, the extensive work has been done in this area. So with this, I'm going to conclude that here I have tried to talk about the future of renewable sources and the role of power electronics for the microgrid installation. I have also covered some of the interfacing power converters and its a coordinated control to feed power to the local user and the grid. And the application of electric vehicle battery and the inherent onboard power electronics converters. I said how this in power electric vehicle is integrated with the grid. And at the same time, so we are taking when we are feeding power to grid through the battery vehicle battery, we have to think that the reactive power compensation as well as the harmonic issues are to be eliminated. Okay, so with this, I think I have taken much time. I took 10-15 minutes more than what I have been allotted. So thank you everybody for your listening. If you have any doubt or any clarification or any suggestion, you are most welcome. So that's thank all from my side.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rakesh Maurya, for a very informative presentation. It was really a very detailed information about the converters and the advantages of the DC power utilities at the microgrid level. Now I think we should go for a quick question session if you allow, doctor.
Yes, sure. I'm open now. One can ask question.
Yeah, I think Mr. Naveen Agrawal having some doubt, some question. Mr. Agrawal. Hello.
Hello.
Good evening. Good evening. This is Naveen Agrawal.
Yes, Dr. Yes, Naveen.
Yeah, good evening. This is a very nice session to attend today. And very much eye-opening and as well as the awareness about this one. Some question I was having to raise, because generally in the utilities, maximum load is on the our establishment or the ACs yeah. Or motorized system, either pumps or the washing machine, etc., like this one, which are generally done with the DC system. Either we have to change it totally, the supply on the BLDC.
Okay.
Is it necessary? If you go
over sir, I got your questions. As I said, the present system is of present existing utility is our AC system, and our operational part of all the equipment, either in the AC loads, means like let's say they talk about the induction motor or BLDC motor, intermediate stage they are converging into DC, and they are further this DC is converted into AC. So what I want to say, as we have our present infrastructure AC, so that is to be converted into DC, as you are doing in the present case. If you don't have that conversion, efficient conversion, because the problem with the AC to DC converter is they are converting DC as well as they are converting into DC, and they are creating power quality problem at the utility side. So if you have a DC side, if you have a sources of a DC network, that can be, you need only DC to AC conversion. So obviously your conversion losses will be improved, because what you are doing in the present system, you are to operate your appliances, you are having two stage of conversion. One is AC to DC and then DC to AC. So for high load or for most of the loads, you have a front-end converter. So my target is, as far as the research says, this conversion is not that much mature, and they have a different disadvantage in the present context. Yes. So looking to the generation, looking to the sources available, it is better to make the DC locally, and you can use in the form of DC as and when required. Yes, sir.
But what about the safety point of view? Is it safe, doctor, to use the DC?
Sir, as far as the literature is concerned, still we are facing problem of their switch gears, their protection system in form of the DC. So even the technology is not mature. In very few countries, even in the prototype lab, they are developing, but still it is not being commercialized till date. So though people are trying, but a lot of safety issue is associated with this network, and that's why we are unable to implement it.
Doctor, one request before everybody leave, can you just click one photograph, just close the presentation, and can you take a screenshot?
Just a minute, sir. It's print screen you want, sir?
Yeah.
It's only going on in recording.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions?
Thank you.
Yeah. Dr. Rakesh, I had one question regarding that. As you told that the decentralized generation, DGs, are the power flow is a bidirectional. This power is a commercial utility power.
Yeah.
So it's the major issue is the power metering, because both way metering, because it will be very difficult for the consumer.
Sir, in this context, I can say that the implementation of this whole system required research in all the domain. As far as the interfacing of DC sources generation to the grid is concerned, we are good enough. Power electronics people are doing, and they are mature in the technology. But as far as the metering part is concerned, and there it is still we have a lacking in that area. The people are working for the smart meter which can record even in some generation like solar. The people have even in Gujarat, we have a provision to record power unit going from the source to you local means from grid to, so you can record power bidirectional, and accordingly the metering is done. So the people are doing, and few PV array people are implementing also. So the meters are also being practiced today. So that can be need to be scale up only.
Yeah, maybe some IEEE guidelines or some metering guidelines, IEC guidelines will.
Yes.
So, Doctor, one question regarding this economical point of view: is it feasible solution to provide this microgrid as compared to extend the existing transmission line up to any of this particular? Except options will be available, but. If you leave aside this very remote villages, if you compare the transmission line extension as compared to the local installation.
Okay.
What about the economical point?
Sir, if you look at the present power consumptions and the rate, if you see the utility rate, I mean the power coming from the utility, the way they are charging, and the distributed generations like PV, so from PV they are charging, so still the rates are, if you see the just World Bank data, they are going down. So the people are using, and as far as the load is concerned, if you, as I said, if you have a DC load around your appliance, your home, they are less power consumptions. They are less power hungry. So you can, even if you have a LED, you have a good intensity of light around you, and their consumption is very less. So as far as power consumption is concerned, they can be looking to that aspect. It is economical. And as far as the utility is concerned, if you see the trend from last 5 years, I'm seeing the power, the cost of PV panel is going down and down. So probably in time to come, they are becoming cheaper, and it can be scale up. But right now, it is not economical.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Arvind, can you just briefly conclude the session?
Thank you, Dr. Rakesh, for giving this informative talk. And most of the audience may not be knowing that we are batchmates in the M.Tech and classmate in the B.Tech. And once again, thank you for accepting our invitation, for giving such a informative lecture. And it was eye-opener for all of us, because the future is going to be the era of renewables. Yes. Because we are looking for the cost-effective solutions. Because if you see in the Dubai, they have bit, I think in Indian currency, if I say, so they are having 3.2 rupees per kilowatt hour, something like that. They have given the contract. So it will be the one of the biggest solar park in Dubai. So maybe, because of technology, the cost will come down once the technology will improve. Another thing is related to smart grid. There is a lot of things are going on, the data security, and even because if we are connected to a smart grid, all the data are exposed to the internet. So anybody can take over the control from the remote area, and it will shut down or something. It will play according to its own desire. So to prevent these things, so data security is again the most important thing. And another thing, we are again going to the second point. I mean, we are going towards the electric vehicle instead of the fuel-based vehicle. We are going to moving towards the electric vehicle. So whole things are all together, if we say, a comprehensive solution for the energy, which will include fuel and electricity. I mean, electricity is generated from the fuel and all. So okay, so I think we in future we will also have tried to connect you with the one new session for this. I think electric charging vehicle presentation. I mean, okay. Some webinar on this. So I think okay.
Okay, okay, Mr. Gupta. I really, it is pleasure for me to be a part of this presentation, and I'm happy to receive invitation from Institution of Engineers. Though it's a tough time for us because the academic schedule is going on, and today we have online classes, COVID, and etc. So people are busy with the different class of environment. So the things are new people are forced to use technology for that. So in NIT, no problem. But as far as the state colleges, schools are concerned, still they are not mature and they are not using this. So, but anyhow, it is a demand of era and we are doing. So thank you all from all the Delhi, all the authority of Institution of Engineers, Bahrain Sec chapter, and for inviting me for this talk. I'll be happy if you give me chance further to share my views. Thank you.
Definitely. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.